Let us consider this topic, Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization procedure. This is the Gram-Schmidt theorem. Given a linearly independent basis vectors, we can form linear combination of these basis vectors to obtain an orthonormal basis. Okay, so suppose we have a set of vectors which are linearly independent. Okay, they can be basis vectors. We know that when a set of number of linearly independent vectors in a set is equal to the dimension of the vector space, then they form a complete set and they can act as the basis of the vector space. So we have a set of basis vectors which are linearly independent. Okay, then this theorem says that we can construct an orthonormal basis from this set of linearly independent vectors by taking proper linear combination of these basis vectors. Okay, so we are not going to prove this theorem formally, but what we are going to do is using this theorem we are going to show how this theorem can be used to construct an orthonormal basis from a linearly independent basis. Okay, so before going to deal with abstract vectors in an n-dimensional complex vector space, let us first consider our familiar physical spatial vectors in the three-dimensional physical space. Okay, so let us consider this illustration with spatial vectors. Consider this plane on the surface of this board, okay, which is two-dimensional surface, a plane. So consider a linearly independent set of vectors here. So we know that on this plane, the dimension of this plane is 2, which means the maximum number of linearly independent vectors that can be chosen in this plane is 2. So if we have any two linearly independent vectors, this we have done in the previous class. If you have two non-parallel vectors on the plane, then they are linearly independent, that we have shown already. So I have chosen two non-parallel vectors, they are linearly independent and they can act as a basis for this space, vector space, this two-dimensional plane. So clearly they are linearly independent, but they are not orthonormal. Their magnitude is not 1, and that means they are not normalized and they are not orthogonal to each other, mutually perpendicular to each other. So how we can use this Gram-Schmidt procedure to construct an orthonormal basis from this linearly independent basis? Okay, let us see. So I will call these vectors as let us say vector A, this is vector B. So this is linearly independent basis. Okay, but they are neither normalized nor orthogonal. So we want to construct an orthonormal set of vectors from this linearly independent set. That's what this theorem says. Let us see how we can do this. Now first we choose one vector, okay, this vector A. Then we can divide this vector A with its own magnitude. Then we get a unit vector along the direction A. Okay, so what we do is take this vector A, okay, and divide it with its own magnitude. Let us call this as a small a. Okay, now this is clearly now normalized vector. Okay, because we have divided vector A with its own magnitude. Now how do you find the magnitude of vector A? It's very simple. This is vector A divided by you take the dot product of vector A with itself and then take the square root of A dot A, that is the magnitude of A. So this is a normalized vector. So let me draw this. This is it, vector A. along the same direction of A, and its magnitude, let's assume that its magnitude is 1. Okay, because we have divided the vector with its own magnitude. So if you take this A dot A, okay, A dot, what is A dot A? It is simply A dot A divided by mod A into mod A, or mod A square. But mod A square is A dot A. So naturally, small a dot small a will be 1. This is clear. Small a dot small a is 1. From here, you get capital A dot capital A. In the denominator, you have A dot A square. This is a scalar. A dot A, square root of A dot A into square root of A dot A. So we get A dot A divided by A dot A. That is 1. Okay. So this is normalized now. Now, what about this one? Now this vector, okay, we can shift geometrically, you know, this vector, you can shift the origin. Only thing is that we can preserve its magnitude and direction. So let me place this vector here. This is vector B. Same direction, same magnitude. I have just shifted the origin so that the origin of small a and this vector B coincide. Now what I do is, you can take the projection of this vector B along the direction of small letter A, I mean small vector A. Okay, this is the direction of small this vector A. We can take the projection of B along this direction. Okay. So what is this part? Okay, so we have a part of B which is parallel to A, and another part of B which is perpendicular. So we can say that this part is B parallel and this part is B perpendicular. So parallel and perpendicular with respect to the small vector A. How do we take this projection? Okay. This is actually, in order to take the projection or component of B along the direction A, what we have to do is, you have to take the dot product between A and B. Okay. In other words, we can say, if this angle is theta, we know that this component is B cos theta. So this is nothing but B cos theta. But more, and this part is B sin theta. Okay, but we'll just focus on this part. This B cos theta, another way of looking at it is, if we take the scalar product between this unit vector, remember this is a unit vector, so unit vector A, and okay, we should say B cos theta is only the magnitude, and what is the direction of this vector? This B parallel is a vector, its magnitude is B cos theta. What is the direction? Direction is the same as the direction of vector A. This is a unit vector. Okay, so the direction of this part, this is the magnitude, and the direction is this. Okay, now if we look at this, this B cos theta part, this magnitude, how we can think about this as follows. You can take the scalar product between this unit vector and this vector B. Okay, this B cos theta is actually the scalar product between this unit vector and this B. So let me write this B cos theta as A dot vector B. This is B cos theta. What is the expansion of A dot B? Magnitude of A. What is the expansion of scalar product or dot product between two vectors? Magnitude of the first vector into magnitude of the second vector into cosine of the angle between the two vectors. Magnitude of the first vector is 1. Magnitude of small vector A. Magnitude of second vector is B. And what is the cosine of the angle between the two vectors? Theta. So this is simply B cos theta. So this B cos theta is the component of B along the direction of A. And that is obtained by taking the scalar product between A and B. We have discussed this in the previous class. For example, you expand a general vector. A general vector, let us say vector A. You expand like this. Ax, I, ay, j. In three dimensions, let us say. Okay. What is this Ax component of vector A along the direction x axis, along the direction of I? what is this ax? This ax is obtained by taking I dot a, taking the inner product between or scalar product between this unit vector along the x axis and the general vector. We get the component of vector along the x direction. Similarly, in order to get a by component of the general vector along the y direction, we need to take j dot a. So in the same way, in order to get the component of b along the direction of this vector a, what you have to take is, this is a unit vector now, you take the scalar product between this unit vector and this vector. That's what we have done here, and its magnitude is b cos theta, and here the direction is a. Okay, so this b parallel is the component parallel to a, and b perpendicular is the component perpendicular to a. Okay, now what is this b? We can look at this b perpendicular as the total vector b minus b parallel, right? You take the original vector b and you subtract the component along the direction a, then we get this one. Okay, or I can say this is equal to b minus, what is b parallel? B parallel is this a dot b along a. Okay, this is b perpendicular, and clearly this vector b perpendicular will be perpendicular to this vector a. Okay, in order to, we can check that this vector is perpendicular to A. Visually we can see that, but algebraically we can check that. How do you check that two vectors are mutually perpendicular? You take the scalar product between them. If the scalar product is zero, that vectors are mutually perpendicular. So I am going to take the scalar product between this small vector A and B perpendicular. Let us see what happens. So A dot B perpendicular is equal to, this is b perpendicular. Okay, so what is this? You have to take dot product between these two parts. So we get a dot b minus, see this is a scalar, so the vector here is this. Okay, so you have to take the scalar product of a with this one. So what you get is a dot b, this is it, into a dot a. Okay, and here a dot a is 1, we know it from here, a is already normalized vector, so we get a dot b minus a dot b, which is 0. So it clearly shows that the vector a and b perpendicular are mutually perpendicular vectors. So we have got from the vector b, we have got a part of b which is perpendicular to this vector a. Okay, so they are orthogonal to each other. Now what is remaining is, this is not normalized vector, we have to normalize this vector. How do we normalize b perpendicular? You take b perpendicular vector and divide with its own magnitude. Okay, how do you get the magnitude of this vector? Take the inner product of the vector with itself. Okay, b perpendicular divided by b perpendicular dot b perpendicular square. This will be the magnitude of b perpendicular, and let us call this vector as small b. Okay, let me mark it here. Maybe I will mark it here. I will draw it here. So this is our small vector a. Okay, let us say this is our small vector b. So we started with two vectors capital A and capital B, which are linearly independent, but which are neither normalized nor orthogonal. Okay, but from that we constructed an orthonormal set of vectors. Now small a and small b are normalized and they are orthogonal to each other, mutually perpendicular. So what is the procedure here? What we have done is, we take the first vector, then normalize it by dividing with its own magnitude. Then we take the second vector b and subtract the component along the direction of the first vector, that is step 2. So what is remaining will be perpendicular to this vector, that we can check by taking the dot product. Now in the third step, we normalize this vector by dividing with its own magnitude. Okay, so we get the normalized vector, which are these two vectors are now mutually perpendicular. So this is the procedure. Okay, it's very clear. So if we have two vectors, take the first vector and normalize it. So we get the normalized vector then. Then take the second vector, subtract from this vector the component which is along the direction of the first vector. Then what is remaining? B minus the component along the direction of the first vector. How do you find the component along the direction of the first vector? You have to take the dot product between the first vector and the second vector. Then you will get the component along this direction. A dot B along the direction A. Then from the original vector B, you subtract this part. You get the remaining part which is perpendicular to A. You can check that it is perpendicular to A. And once you get this vector which is perpendicular to A, you have to normalize it. Then for that, you just divide with its own magnitude. So this is a simple procedure. This is for two vectors. You can extend this procedure, this construction for any number of vectors. Okay. If you take a third vector, then you have to ensure that it is, let's say you have another vector C. Then naturally you cannot do that on the plane. You have to get you need to go to three dimensional space to get three linearly independent vectors. So if you have a vector C, what you do is you subtract from it. Okay, so you have A and B already, you have done this procedure and you have orthonormal set. Now you have another vector C, suppose C is along this direction. Okay, now you want an orthonormal set for these three. Then what you do is you take C, A and B is already normalized and orthogonal. Now you take C, then you subtract from it the component along the direction A and the component along the direction B. So from C, subtract component along direction A and component along direction B. Whatever is remaining will be perpendicular to both A and B. We can check that by taking the scalar product with A and B, small a and small b. And finally, what you have to do, you have to normalize the whatever remaining part of C, you have to normalize by dividing with its magnitude. So in this way, this type of a construction can be extended to any number of vectors. Okay, so far we have been discussing spatial vectors, illustrating this Gram-Schmidt theorem using spatial vectors in two-dimensional surface, also three-dimensional space. Now we want to deal with abstract vectors, and let us see how we do this in the case of abstract ket vectors in the abstract complex vector space. Let us see. So let ket 1, I am using Roman numerals for these linearly independent vectors which are not orthonormal yet. So let ket 1, ket 2, ket 3, all Roman numerals, etc. So I will represent it as a set. So let this set be a set of linearly independent vectors. Okay, they may or may not be basis vectors. So the question is how we can generate an orthonormal set of vectors from this. Okay. So first we take this first vector. Okay. Then we can simply normalize it. So what is what we are going to do is let ket 1 is equal to ket Roman numeral 1 divided by its norm. So ket 1, this Arabic numeral 1, is equal to ket 1 by its modulus. And how do you get the modulus? Take the inner product of this vector with itself and take the square root. That is ket 1 by inner product of 1 with itself square root. So this is our first vector. This is clearly normalized. Okay, you can check that get 1 with itself is equal to what happens. This is a scalar, okay, and remember this is also real. Then if you take the inner product, what you get is get 1 with itself. In the denominator you have this symbol again, one more value, so we get 1 1, which is, so it is normalized. Now let us look at the second vector. What you have to do, you have to take the second vector and subtract its component along the first vector. Now the first vector is this normalized vector. So let me define it like this. Let ket 2 prime is equal to ket 2 minus, I am calling this vector as 2 prime. Okay, what is this? This plays the role of B perpendicular in the previous discussion. That means this is our second vector. You have to subtract its component along the direction of this vector, this first vector. Now we don't have to worry about this. Let's consider this one. Instead of small vector A, we have this one. And once you subtract the component along the first vector, whatever remaining will be perpendicular to that. Okay, and this vector let me call 2 prime. So what is the component along the first vector? How do you find the component of ket 2 along the direction ket 1? How do you find? You have to take the inner product of this ket 1 and inner product of this 2 with, or inner product of ket 1 with this 1. Just like Ax, if we expand a general vector in three-dimensional space, you have Axi, Ayj, Sk. How do you get Ax? What is the component of general vector along the x direction? You have to take I dot A. Okay, in the same way, here the unit vector is now this one, and you take the inner product of this with this one. Okay, so we have to take inner product of 1 with ket 2. This is the component along the direction 1, and but this is a vector, so you have to get the vector also. This is only the magnitude, and what is the vector? It's a ket 1. The direction is decided by the unit vector along this one, which is ket 1. What is the first component of the general vector in the three dimensional space? Axi. So Ax is obtained by I dot Ax. Okay, so I dot A along the I direction. So Axi or I dot A along I. That is it. So here what we have done is we have taken this part is the component of ket 2 along the direction of ket 1. That's what. This is something like Ax, this is something like I dot A, and this is the unit vector along the direction of 1, ket 1. So from ket 2, we have subtracted the component along ket 1, and what is remaining will be perpendicular to ket 1. So this ket 2 per prime will be exactly perpendicular to this one. Orthogonal, we have to say orthogonal, because these vectors can be anything, from ordinary vectors to square matrices to functions. Okay, so we cannot visualize them as perpendicular, but let's use the abstract idea of generalization of perpendicularity, orthogonal. So 2 prime will be orthogonal to 1. You can check that. Let's take the inner product between them. Okay, that is find ket 1 and 2 prime. Okay, this is 2 prime. So take the inner product with these two terms. What do you get? 1 with ket 2 minus, this is a scalar, so what you have to take is take the inner product with this vector. So 1 ket 2, and you have to take the inner product of 1 with this one, so we have 1 1, and this quantity is 1 already, we know that. Okay, so then what is remaining is 1 with ket 2, so this and this will subtract, so you get 0. Okay, this shows that 2 prime is perpendicular to or orthogonal to 1. So this is, let's call it equation 2. We get 2 prime, but still this is not normalized. Now we have to normalize it. So we can say let ket 2 is equal to ket 2 prime divided by modulus of ket 2 prime. Okay, so once you know this vector, you can find the modulus. How? Take the inner product of the vector with itself and take the square root, then you get the modulus. So then divide ket 2 prime with its modulus, you get the normalized vector. So this is 3. Now this ket 1 and ket 2 are mutually orthonormal. Each of them are normalized and they are orthogonal to each other. Clearly, if 2 prime and 1 are orthogonal, then clearly 2 and 1 are orthogonal, no doubt. Okay, what about the third vector? So I am taking ket 3 and I am defining ket 3 prime. How? So from ket 3, this is now Roman ket, I am subtracting the component along the direction of ket 1 and component along the direction of ket 2, both. So first let us take the component along the direction ket 2. What is the component along the direction ket 2? You have to take the inner product between ket 2 and 3 with the direction as ket 2. So it is like this, ket 2, bra vector 2 and this ket 3 along the direction 2. So this is the component of ket 3 along the direction 2 and the direction is given by this one. So I have subtracted from ket 3 the component along the direction 2. Not only that, you have to subtract the component along direction 1 also, because this vector, new vector, should be orthogonal to both ket 1 and ket 2. Okay, so again subtract the component along the direction 1, okay, which is 1, 3 along the direction 1. Okay. So this vector, it's guaranteed that this vector will be perpendicular to both 1 and 2. Okay, we can verify that. Find this one, 2 with 3 prime. Okay, so what is that? It is 2, 3 minus, this is a scalar, so we have to take the inner product with this one. So we have 2, 3, 2, 2 minus, this is again scalar, so there is, it remains like that. You have to take the inner product with this one. So 2 and 1. Now this quantity is 1 because our vector ket 2 is normalized. Now this quantity is 0 because ket 2 and ket 1 are mutually orthogonal. Already we have settled that. So if this is 1 and this is 0, then this term will have no contribution. This is 1, then this minus this will be 0. That means 3 prime is now orthogonal to ket 2. What about 1? So ket 1 with 3 prime. Here, so 1, ket 3, and here minus, this is a scalar. You take the inner product with this one, so 1 with 2 minus, and finally here take the inner product with this one. Okay, and this is again 0 because 1 and 2 are mutually orthogonal. If this is 0, this is also 0, and here this is 1 because ket 1 is normalized. So this part will go to 0. 1, 3 minus 1, 3 will be 0. So clear that, it's clear that this 3 prime, ket 3 prime will be orthogonal to both ket 1 and ket 2. Now we have to, only thing remaining is we have to normalize this one. So let simply ket 3 is equal to ket 3 prime divided by modulus of ket 3 prime. Ket Okay, modulus we can evaluate by taking the inner product of 3 prime with itself and taking the square root. Okay, so now we can say that this set 1, 2 Arabic numerals, 3, etc. is an orthonormal set. Okay, I'm continuing the equation number. I think this is equation 5. This is equation 6. So we started with a set of linearly independent vectors and we ended up with an orthonormal set. So this is the Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization procedure or construction. Once we have a set of linearly independent vectors, we can construct an orthonormal set from that. So this shows that since it is guaranteed that we can construct an orthonormal set from a linearly independent set, whenever we have a linearly independent set of vectors, we can simply assume that they are also orthonormal sets. Okay. And if we look at these new vectors, 3 prime for example, they are linear combinations of the old set of vectors. Okay. See, for example, 3 prime is ket 3, ket Roman letter 3, Roman vector ket 3. This is a scalar and you have this ket 2 here, ket 1 here. But ket 2 is obtained as a linear combination of the old vectors, and ket 1 is also can be written in terms of the old vectors. I will show that. So what I am trying to say is, this is the expression for ket 3 prime. It contains ket 3, the old vector ket 3, and then this is a scalar, but it contains ket 2 and ket 1. But what is ket 2? Ket 2 is ket 2 prime by modulus 2. What is ket 2 prime? Ket 2 prime is old vector ket 2 minus its component along ket 1. So actually ket 2 contains the old vector ket 2 here. And this ket1 is old vector ket1 by its modulus. So ket1 contains old vector ket1. So here in ket2, you have ket2 is actually linear combination of old vector ket2 and ket1. And ket1 is a constant times the old vector ket1. So the point is, this ket1, ket2, okay, 2 is ket2 is simply 2 prime by modulus. Ket 3, etc., they are all linear combinations of these old set of vectors, proper linear combinations, and these are the coefficients. Not exactly this, because more coefficients are involved here. So some proper coefficients multiplied by the old vector. Okay, the sign can be plus minus, etc. So if you take the proper linear combinations between the old vectors, then you get the new set of orthonormal vectors. And the idea of these linear combinations are basically you take a vector and subtract its components along the direction of the other vectors. That's the idea. And then take the normalization also by dividing with its modulus. So this is the construction of Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization procedure. Now we can ask a question here. Is this procedure possible if some of these vectors are linearly dependent? In other words, for such a construction to happen, is it absolutely necessary that this set of vectors, original set of vectors, are linearly independent? Where is this linear independence comes in this construction? See, one thing what we have to note is that this ket1, ket2, ket3, I mean 2 prime is, from that we can construct 2, from ket 3 prime we can construct 3 by dividing with the norm. So this ket 1, ket 2, ket 3, the new set, are all linear combinations of the old set of vectors. Okay. Now if you have a set of linearly independent vectors, okay, then a linear relationship between them, something like a1 ket1 plus a2 ket2 plus a3 ket3 etc. equal to 0. such a, if they are mutually linearly independent, if these vectors, then a linear relationship between them cannot happen. If this linear relationship is possible for non-zero values of a1, a2, a3, etc., then it means that they are not linearly independent. Okay. So that means a linear combination of these linearly independent vectors equal to zero cannot happen. It will not be equal to zero. That's what we have discussed in the linear independence of vectors. That means this type of a linear relation, summation over I ai ket I equal to zero, this type of a linear relation cannot happen for a set of linearly independent vectors like ket 1, ket 2, ket 3, etc., ket n. Or in other words, such a linear relation can happen only for the trivial case that all the ai values, coefficients, are all zero. So these ket 1, ket 2, ket 3, etc., are all linear combinations of this set. Okay. So if they are, since they are linearly independent, if they are linearly independent, it means that then this linear combination cannot be equated to zero. Okay, this type of a relation, a linear combination equal to zero, cannot happen. So it's because these vectors are linearly independent that we get non-zero values of ket 1, ket 2, ket 3, etc. If there are n vectors here, you get n vectors here also in the orthonormal set. On the other hand, if some of these vectors are linearly dependent, then at one stage their linear combinations will be equal to zero. That means if you continue to construct such linear combinations, at some stage ket 3 or ket 4 or ket 5 will become zero. Okay, so this construction cannot proceed. So that is it. So you know, for this construction to happen, because this construction is basically taking linear, proper linear combinations between this set, so this linear combination cannot be equal to zero if they are truly linearly independent. So it's because they are linearly independent that we get non-zero vectors in the orthonormal set. That's where this linear independence comes. As an illustration of this Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization construction, let us consider this problem. Form an orthonormal basis in two dimensions, starting with vector A equals 3i plus 4j and vector B equal to 2i minus 6j. So two vectors are given in Cartesian coordinates. So these are obviously vectors on a plane. So they are linearly independent vectors. As it is clear here, we cannot write one vector as a scalar times the other. Okay, these are 3i plus 4j, this is 2i minus 6j, so we cannot write one as a multiple of the other. Okay, so we start with these linearly independent vectors and we have to construct an orthonormal set. So for that, let's start like this. Let's take the first vector as before. Then you divide this with its norm to get one vector in our orthonormal set. So let vector A equals this capital A by its norm. Okay. So what is the norm of vector A? It's two dimensional vector, so it's very easy, square root of 3 square plus 4 square. Okay, so square root of 3 square plus 4 square, which is square root of 9 plus 16, square root of 25, which is 5. So mod A is 5, so we divide this with 5, so we have this is equal to 1 by 5 into 3i plus 4j, that's equal to 3 by 5 is 0.6 plus 4 by 5 is 0.8. Okay, so this is 0.6i plus 0.8j. This is our small vector A. So this is our one vector in the orthonormal set. Now let us take this vector. So let us define, let B prime, okay, equal to, take the vector B, okay, vertices and subtract its component along the direction A. So B minus, what is the component of B along the direction A? So for that you have to take the dot product of A with B along the direction A. A dot B A. Right? So we want to find out this A dot B along the direction A. So first of all, what is A dot B? A dot B. This is small a, and take the dot product with this. So we get 0.6 into 2, we get 1.2 minus 0.8 into 6, 4.8. Okay. So this is minus 3.6. Okay, this part is minus 3.6, and this you have to multiply with A. Okay, so that means you have to multiply this A with minus 3.6. So the result is, the result of this part, A dot B times A is basically minus 3.6 times this, and its value is minus 2.16 I minus 2.88 J. This is this part. Now vector B is 2I minus 6J. So what you have to do is 2I minus 6J minus this one, minus 2.16 I minus 2.88 J. Okay. So minus of minus will be plus. So we have 2i minus 6j plus 2.16i plus 2.88j. Okay. And the value is 4.16i minus 3.12j. So this is B prime. Okay. Now we want to find vector B. Vector B prime divided by modulus B prime. So for that we want to find out the modulus of this vector. This modulus B prime, okay, is the square root of 4.16 square plus 3.12 square, and its value is 5.2. You can try to do this, its value is 5.2. And you divide these two terms with 5.2, what you get is 0.8i minus 0.6j. So this is our vector A, this is our vector B. Now these two vectors, vector A and vector B, will form orthonormal set. Okay, vector A is clearly normalized, you can check that, and vector B is also normalized. Actually the coefficients are just interchanged here with a minus sign. So if this is normalized, this is also normalized, and you can also check A and B are orthogonal to each other. Take A dot B. A dot B is 0.6 times 0.8, 0.48 plus 0.48 minus 0.48, its value is 0. So A dot B is 0. Okay. So we started with a linearly independent set capital A and capital B, and ended up with an orthonormal set. So this is an illustration of this Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization procedure. So in the same way, here I have used basically spatial vectors which are familiar to us, but if we have matrices, square matrices, or if we have n tuples, or if we have functions, then also this procedure will work. You might have studied Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization procedure, orthonormalization procedure in the context of functions when you studied Sturm-Liouville theory in differential equations. That idea is same as this one. The two ideas are same because functions can be treated as vectors. So today what we have discussed is a general procedure for getting an orthonormal set of vectors. So many quantities including functions can be treated as vectors, and the same procedure is applicable there also.